Good evening, everyone. And I know I first wanted to both thank and congratulate the authors of the beautiful sign on the facade of Avery, which makes us look really good and engaged. And I'm sure we have many outside who will trickle in into the lecture. So tonight we're really excited to welcome vPPR in the spirit of the school's continuing to support emerging practices and also returning alumni and also three incredible women working together. So that's our contribution to a new era. Yes. So I welcome tonight Tatiana von Preussen, who's in M.Arch from 2007, Catherine Pease and Jessica Reynolds. And even though it's a young practice, it's fair to say that vPPR has developed a few striking characteristics. On the one hand, they offer very bold designs and really create an architecture that is sort of has a kind of very honest, clear, a sort of boldness to it, but their work also has an intelligence in how it deals with the complexity of context and reinterprets it. The firm has designed buildings that always try to kind of engage that context and find opportunities within its constraints, and always bring a level of kind of both expertise but also playfulness in the way, in particular, their buildings and projects negotiate the private and the kind of public spheres. I would also say that this kind of striking quality is not just in their buildings, but also visible through their drawings, with a real attention to representation and drawings that speak in a kind of very complex and beautiful way about the discipline. They both practice in the UK and abroad, and across a number of scales, from masterplans to private houses, and from cultural to commercial. And in particular, I really always have found that they are trying to kind of reinvent the everyday and reinvent building types to find new ways of being. I think for us it's very exciting to see the kind of experimentation they have brought to housing, particularly in facing the challenge of building, again, on highly constrained sites and within London's very dense fabric. And even as they engage questions of housing, always trying to find ways to weave sort of art and architecture, not as this kind of separate from, but rather as a way to find creative solutions that engage a sense of community and that engage communities, no matter how large or small the projects are. Tatiana von Preussen, Catherine Pease, and Jessica Reynolds met at Cambridge University and proceeded respectively to Columbia GSAPP for Tatiana, the AA for Catherine, and Princeton for their graduate studies. Each of them has worked in New York before returning to London at the height of the recession to start their firm. It is always a good idea, by the way, to start at the height of a recession, because you can only go up from there. It's kind of like how we are right now in general. They have built work in London, Switzerland, Cardiff, and I hope that this invitation and their kind of hanging out in New York will start to reconnect them with this context. And I just wanted to mention key projects. The first one is Odd's Yard, in which the firm worked as developers and architects. And the two homes are really interesting and are inside the center of a block of row houses and oriented towards a central courtyard to minimize the impact on the surrounding block. So again, really thinking in a very interesting way about context, and that won an number of awards, such as the Year Blue Ribbon Awards in 2014, the Ideal Housing Architect, and the Reba London Award in 2014. And that it was finalist as part of Reba Stephen Lawrence Award in 2014 as well. And the second one is a beautiful project called the Vaulted House, which reinvent not only context, but actually preservation. And we're certainly very sort of interested in that here at the school, rethinking how we can engage our kind of post-industrial fabric. And that, again, won a number of awards, such as the Reba London Award of 2015 and the London Emerging Practice Award also of 2015. So please join me in welcoming vPPR. And the response will be given by our very own Adam Frampton. So stick around.
Thank you so much, Dean Andros, for having us, and all of you for coming. There's a lot going on in the city at the moment, so really appreciate your support here tonight. We were very flattered to be invited, and it's particularly special for me and as alumni to be standing on the other side of the podium. I can cue the slides, I think. As Dean Andros described, we met as undergrads and started just the three of us in the financial recession around Catherine's kitchen table in London. We're now 12 people in the office in East London. We happen to be predominantly women in the office, but it's not by design. There are a couple of men now, in fact, working for us. It's a really great team, and I really wanted to thank our team. It's very collaborative. There's a great atmosphere in the office, and a really kind of great buzz, and they really contribute to all of the projects that we have. So when we moved back, there was this sort of identity crisis of coming from the States, having had this incredible formal freedom at Columbia. It was really just at the end of the big formal era with kind of Greg Lynn and Jeff Kipnis, and this was an image from Hanan Diaz-Alonso's studio, doing these kind of crazy animals out of Maya objects. And then coming back to London, and this is the kind of context, the kind of Victorian terrace house, and how on earth do you begin to bring anything like that back into the city? The terraced house actually became a key research exercise for us, and we were invited by the RABA recently to participate in an exhibition for the House of Tomorrow, and we were asked to look at the terraced house in particular. And one of the kind of key defining aspects of terraced house is the party wall. So it's the structural wall that's shared between the two houses to either side, and we began to speculate that what if actually, instead of sharing a wall, you began to share space in the context of the incredible tightness in London now, and this kind of lack of space, really, lack of space for people. And if you could share the house to either side and you kind of could condense all of the private functions into the wall, then you could effectively have a house that was twice as wide, but you would be sharing the space to either side with your neighbor. And also this sort of feeling that in Britain, and I think possibly in America, that the communal spaces are viewed slightly with suspicion, and that really if you could just share with one other person, that maybe that would be palatable for British. They like their private space. So the other thing that interested us about the terraced house was the idea of it as a kind of cell in a grid. So it's just a very simple grid, and in a way the terraced house is hard to reinvent because it's such a flexible typology. But we began to think that actually if you could take the idea of wallpaper, which itself is a grid, really repeated, that allows you to have kind of continuous sinuous curves across a large area, that you could almost use that to produce the plan of the terraced house. So we took this pattern by Voisey, and it was for a notional new development in Cumbria, which is his birthplace, and we use that pattern as an underlying pattern to generate the plan. So you can see the blue areas are all the private functions in the house, so they've been kind of squeezed into the wall. They do conform to the London space standards. And there are three bedrooms, a sitting room, kitchen, and so forth. And then you have these spaces to either side that are the shared spaces. And the geometry does allow those spaces to feel very kind of open, rather than being kind of divided, which I think would be the case if it was an orthogonal geometry. So we're very interested in these kind of gradients between public and private spaces. And the kind of addition of these plans together produces a kind of larger pattern that could be applied to a whole new town, which has even still the feel of some of the London terraced houses with their rounded bay windows and the kind of repetition. And it could be, the pattern could itself become landscape, way to generate landscape patterns, public buildings, street furniture. And this is a kind of view in the interior of the space where you have kind of balconies and windows overlooking. And you could use the space, for instance, as a shared play area for children or a shared office space. And it's really up to you, the two neighbors on either side, to program that space. So we have had opportunities to test these explorations of typologies in London, and these are the sites that we're working on. Some of them are built, some of them are in process of being built, and they're scattered all over the city. But the one thing that they really have in common is that they are all infill sites. So they all are subject to very similar constraints. They tend to be surrounded by back gardens, or they're squeezed into kind of little pockets of leftover former industrial spaces. They're often very strange shapes, and they're overlooked on all sides. So we've kind of almost brought these together as a series of experimentations with different forms that these infill projects could take. And this is just a grid of the projects that some of the projects that we're working on, and there actually are others not on this grid. There are sort of five principles of infill house, which I think are useful in kind of the structure of this talk. The fifth facade is this idea about the roof. The perimeter walls, often you can't have any windows because they would be overlooking into someone's garden or into the back of someone's house. So you're really left with one primary facade, which is the roof, and all the light has to come down through the roof. But also it's this facade that's seen, because the rest of the house is tucked away in this kind of courtyard. And so how that facade is expressed becomes a kind of new kind of creative experiment, and you'll see in some of the projects that becomes really where a lot of the design work is concentrated. So that idea of the fifth facade creates this inverted section where, you know, often in houses the bedrooms are upstairs, the living space is downstairs by the garden, and we end up kind of usually flipping that relationship. So we have all of the living spaces and the communal spaces upstairs near the light, bedrooms go down below, and light is brought to those bedrooms through interior courtyards with a roof light, but also outdoor rooms, which act as sort of outdoor courtyards, completely surrounded by the house itself. And they often function really as living rooms as well for the very few weeks of the year that we have nice weather in London. And then the other thing is that the sites, because they feel so constrained, often the building is sunk, there's a danger that they could feel very constricted. And so we use these kind of classical enfilade ideas of lining up all the doors and the windows in order to create maximum vistas through the site. So really try to extend the space, the feeling of space in the site. This is a vaulted house that Amar mentioned earlier. And you can see it's surrounded completely by gardens. And the entrance is here on the street, and in fact, it just looks like a garage door. It's completely unannounced. You would have no idea this was there. And the only way you can see it are from the upper floors in these surrounding buildings at the back windows. So you come through this underpass, and there's a little courtyard, and then you enter the house on the corner. And this is the house from the block at the back. The perimeter walls are all existing walls. It was a taxi garage previously. And we've just simply spanned the structure off those existing walls. So the whole roof that floats up here is just structurally spanning off those existing brick walls. And it forms this kind of checkerboard harlequin pattern that's visible from the buildings around. And here you can see this principle of having the living spaces upstairs near to these vaults that bring light down into the living space. And then the bedrooms and bathrooms on this floor, and then these double height spaces, the entrance hall, playroom, garden, and a courtyard back here. And the vaults are positioned with a roof light above over different zones in this open plan communal space. So there's almost a sort of essentially a vault above every table, every significant table. So there's a sitting room, and the vault is over the coffee table, and there's the kitchen island and the dining room. And this courtyard here has a little balcony, and these doors slide completely back into the wall so that this can almost become like an external, like a loggia in the summer. And there's a sort of relationship between the kitchen and the playroom, visual relationship. So there's a lot of thoughts about how the house is used in a domestic environment in the plan. So here you see the bedrooms downstairs, four bedrooms, three bathrooms, utilities, and here the playroom, a lot of storage, and the roof patterns here. This is the kind of entrance section. So you come in, you go up onto the upper floor and down to the lower floors. Courtyards and interior double height spaces. And so the inside, the vault, is very crisply detailed. It's not really, doesn't express the structure. The structure is actually enormous. There's an enormous beam in here, which is completely concealed by the finishes. And this, so we were trying to really create a feeling of a lightweight insertion into the existing building. And the language of this vault then also comes through into the details, other details in the house. So it becomes the fireplace, becomes here a window, which is it's a translucent glass window, and also onto the floor, which has a sort of reflected ceiling plan of the vault. So it has this kind of crisscross. Very simple materials. We never seem to have enough left in the budget to do complicated materials. And then this is the roof. So you can see it's just, again, very simple materials in two tones of a single ply membrane, and it just meets very crisply on the edges. And this, again, was very complicated to hide all of the structure, so you didn't have any structure popping up either. And the vault, again, appearing in the door, the entrance door, in the brickwork, and that's at night. And so this is Ott's yard. This was actually... did this before the vaulted house. It's two houses around the central courtyard, and they each have a garden, and it's accessed down this really long, really narrow passageway. So that was another challenge, was how we had to dig this house out, and how we got the spoil up and down here was a real challenge for the contractors. The neighbors were very important to the resolution of this project, and we held an exhibition. When the site was still derelict, it was this timber yard. It was quite an amazing labyrinthine site. And we had artists from all over the world came, and they installed objects within the timber yard. And it brought the neighbors in, and it began a discussion about the site. And it kind of brought them on side, I think. And in the end, I think their support was essential in getting this through planning. So this is what the houses look like from the neighbors. They have these green roofs with different planting in the different sections of the roofs. And it's really about kind of continuing the language of the gardens across the roofs of the site. So this is the geometry. It's a found geometry, really, a fractal, triangular pinwheel fractal. It happened to be exactly the geometry of the site. So we could put it on the site. This is the empty site, filling it with green, the kind of continuation of the gardens around. There are 23 party walls on this project, so there's a lot of neighbors that needed to be brought on side. Subdividing it once to create the courtyard and the two gardens, subdividing again to create the roof lights and the planters. And then actually further subdividing it in terms of the floor finishes. So the bricks are laid in these different patterns, and the tiles in the house on the ground floor also, they were just big rectangular tiles that we cut on a bias and then arranged in this in these patterns. So there's you can see the bedrooms and bathrooms downstairs below a mezzanine level, and then over the kitchen and dining room is a sort of 1.5 height space, and these are the private gardens. So you can see this is mezzanine level, roof. The section is also triangle. So the kitchen and dining room is in this area, and the sitting room is up here. And the bedrooms and bathrooms are below. And the roof light forms this kind of central pivot in the middle of the space. So this is the courtyard. It's a bit wintry in this photograph. It's actually very green in the summer. And the landscaping was a very important element in this project. And I've just been working at a landscaping practice at field operations, and so very keen to try to integrate some of those ideas into the project. Very large amounts of areas of glass, fixed glazing, and views that were very carefully choreographed, so they weren't looking directly into anyone's garden. This is the courtyard. It's really the heart of the project. It has a table and chairs. The dogs play there. The children play there. It's really the heart of the house, of the two houses, and it really functions as a communal space. It's a bit like this idea of the terrace, the Reba project. That if this you just roofed this over, you know, what could you use this space for? And then this is the actual space in the house, the dining room and the kitchen with the roof light above. And here, just seeing the finishes with the fractal pattern on the floor, and even some little triangles on the kitchen surfaces and the bathroom, and the planting on the roofs. So this isn't an infill site. I wanted to put it in here because it's in fact the opposite of an infill site. It's a house in Switzerland on a mountain, and it has 360 degree views all around. There's nothing there. But somehow, while we were designing it, some of those principles that we had established in the infill sites began to seep into this project as well. And some of these ideas about geometry, this almost was fractal as well, this self-similar objects that are arranged in a spiral. This is the site. It's like a chocolate box, beautiful. And there's cows everywhere with bells clanging, and I mean, it's really something else. We became very interested in landscape painting. There's a huge tradition of Swiss landscape artists, and in kind of framing views through the windows in the house. So here you can see the house, and there's really just nothing for ages on a hill. Just to say that this is north, sort of north-south, very strong prevailing winds here that we were conscious to try to create a protective zone in the middle of the house. So this courtyard is shielded from those winds by the bulk of the house that kind of progressively these sort of objects they kind of move around. So all the bedrooms and bathrooms are still on the ground floor. We just felt that the views were so spectacular that we wanted really to take advantage of those by having the primary living spaces at the top of the house with the biggest windows, the biggest views down. And also we just thought this is a house where people come to visit rather than stay all year round. And there's just a practical thing of bringing your luggage in on the ground floor. This is a studio for a painter. The couple are, the clients, a painter, and she meditates. So this is the upper plan. We go from the painting studio up the stairs to the kitchen, and up some more stairs to the sitting room, and then finally up to a small platform where she can meditate, but she can also see across the courtyard to the painting studio. So they have a kind of relationship across the courtyard without her meditation being spoilt by the smell of turpentine. And here is the kind of progression in the section through the house. So it becomes really like a kind of mountain walk. It's like you're spiraling around a mountain. And the roof is also, rather like our infill projects, becomes really important in expressing this kind of mountainous landscape. So here it is sitting in the landscape, these kinds of sets of roofs, and this very large area of glazing facing to the south, down the valley, and potentially a sort of fire pit in the middle. And this is the cow path that runs past, so the cow kind of can look into your bedroom window. You can meditate and look at the cow. So this is showing the kind of relationship of the rooms to the central courtyard, all these sort of views through into the house as well as outside. And so you can see from the meditation space down to the painting studio, and you can also keep an eye on people in the kitchen, but behind it is this amazing backdrop of the mountains around. And this, it's my last slide, is just to show the Swiss have this rather amazing thing that they do while the project is in planning. They create the outline of the house with these sticks. I think normally they probably would have four sticks that would show the envelope, but because it's so complicated, it's more like a forest of sticks. But it really means you can envisage what the house would be like on the site. And so it's quite interesting. This slide. I'm going to pass over to Catherine's going to go back to infill. More serious subjects.
While Tania's been discussing infill sites in the context of private developers and individuals, I'm going to be discussing infill sites in context of the wider housing crisis. Small developers have really shown that it's possible to get the most out of this unused land, which previously had been unviable. Until recently, we call it the council in England, it's the local government, had thought that their own land was unviable as well for these smaller infill sites. And recently, because there's such a shortage of land, there's this huge housing crisis in the UK. But also at the same time, there's been a release of funds to local governments. There's this new thinking that there's potential to build on public land these smaller developments. And the potential is for hundreds of thousands of new homes on these infill lands across London and potentially across the country. So this graph really illustrates the sort of story of housing since post-war housing. So while up until the 1980s, there was a huge amount of housing being built in London. In fact, across the UK, with at its peak over 350,000 new homes being built every year in the UK. In the 1960s, fast forward 2010s up until now, there's only about 140,000 new homes being built in the UK every year. And the pink line illustrates the house prices, and there's a correlation between less houses being built and huge house prices in the UK. You can be young, well employed, but still not be able to afford a home. So it's hugely problematic. And I think what's interesting about this graph is that this top area shows local authorities and their involvement in housing. And up until the 1980s, when Thatcher's government came to power, local authorities were really at the forefront of building housing in the UK, and they had this visionary sort of lead across the country, and had an equal standing to developers. And in the 1980s, due to the change in government, there was no more public housing, and so there's a strong correlation between the two. And now there's this new thinking that we need more housing, and therefore local government has to get involved. I'm going to look at three three public housing projects, just to give you a brief history of UK council projects, but also their projects which we feel are influential to our practice. So the first project is the Boundary Estate, and this is the first example of council housing in the UK. It's, these all three projects I'm going to discuss are in London. And it was hugely visionary at the time. It was built to replace the Victorian slums. The slums were demolished to replace it with over 5,000 new homes. And these new tenement buildings were built around the central circus, known as Arnold Circus. And the public space was at core of the housing. And then off each of these buildings, there are these secondary public communal spaces which create, which really strengthen the community, and this hierarchy of more private and less private communal spaces is really strong. And today there's still this very strong sense of community in these houses, and it's now in the heart of Shoreditch. And it's very desirable housing. I mean, some of it's been sold off and is private, but there's still a lot of public flats in there. And the other part of the other influential aspect of this project is they're generally quite simple buildings, but there's this very intricate brickwork on all the buildings, which sort of breaks down the mass and is very playful. And this you can see in our own projects. The second project is Alexandra Road, again in London. And this was built in the 70s when there was this sort of idealism and vision. It's built, designed by Neve Brown, who believed in creating a front door to every home and creating terraces and a private space for every home. And in the same way as the Boundary Estate, there's this sort of interesting relationship between the more public area, but also these sort of private terraces cascading down the buildings. And we particularly like this sort of canyon effect, where the gardens and the architecture really sort of combine to soften the landscape. And in fact, this project was developed in response to a very awkward site. It runs, there's a railway that, in fact, runs parallel on this side. And the canyon shape was a way of stopping the noise and the vibrations from the trains. The third project I'm going to show is Robin Hood Gardens, designed by Alison and Peter Smithson in the 1970s. And this has been a very much discussed project in the UK in recent years, and recently, because it's going to be demolished. There are currently several hundreds of flats, and this is going to be replaced by several thousands of flats. And it's been very controversial because obviously it's an architectural icon, but to most people, it represents the everything that's wrong with the vision of the brutalist visions of the 70s. These sort of big, hard concrete buildings with and they're seen as to represent poverty and inhumanity in terms of scale. So this is now going to be demolished, and the local tenants, the tenants are going to be displaced. And this has also happened on other council estates around London, and has created a lot of protest. But the issue is that there's such a shortage of land in London that now councils are looking at demolishing certain estates, rather than trying to preserve them, because there's also this issue of maintenance, and there's been very little maintenance to these buildings since the 1980s, when some of the flats began to be sold off under Thatcher's government. So there's this sort of movement of demolition with some councils, but other councils feel it's more appropriate to try and work with the buildings that are already there and sort of build in between. And one such council is Croydon Council, who we are now working with. The Croydon had its own vision in the 1960s with big roads, tall buildings. It was sort of seen as the forefront of idealism, but actually the reality is that the community got broken up by the roads, and again there's this lack of human scale in some of the architecture of the 60s and 70s. However, today Croydon is again at the forefront of this visionary leading the way amongst other councils in London. Currently, there's a target to build 1.5 million new houses by 2050. Approximately 24,000 new homes are being built each year, but there's a need for 50,000 new homes. And each council around London has a target to build X amount of homes, and most of them are failing to do that. And one of the main reasons until now has been that it's just been developers sort of filling the numbers. So actually, councils had very little control. But now councils such as Croydon are trying to develop both larger sites, but also these smaller infill sites on their land. So they are looking at the moment to develop approximately 50 sites and build 1,000 new homes across these smaller 50 sites. And there are 7 architects involved in that, sort of design-led architects. And we are one of these 7 architects. So we are working on 3 sites in Croydon, and they're all similar sites to those that Tanya discussed earlier. And they're very constrained. They've got neighbours in very close proximity around. And they've got restricted access as well. This is the access on these ones. And the main challenges is how do you minimize the impact on the neighboring communities? How do you weave into the neighboring communities? How do you stop views looking directly into the neighboring buildings? How do you reduce the mass so that you don't have an impact on daylight and sunlight? And in the UK, planning laws are very strict about how much daylight and sunlight you can take away from surrounding buildings. And also there's the question of context and building, even though they aren't the most beautiful contexts, they are still sensitive in a sort of planning sense. So this is the context for 2 of the sites. It's post-war. These houses were all built between the 1930s and 1960s, and represent the sort of very typical evenly spaced terraced house, which are typical of many of the low-rise developments, council estate developments of that time. There are some very few leftover sites, but this is one of them, a sort of garage site where the access is so narrow that you can't even get a modern, larger car down there anymore. And then the second site is over here in another garage site. So Cold Harbour Road is, as I explained, garages with a narrow access and buildings in close proximity. In designing the house, our first move was to create a block that was set away from the 2 boundaries. So there's a path for public access at the front and then gardens at the rear. And by setting away from the boundaries, we had less of an impact on the neighbours. The second move was to sort of reference the local vernacular and break down the scale. So we sort of rotated the roofs to create 4 smaller roofs. The next move was to push the building in and out to create a series of entrance courtyards and terraces above. And instead of projecting balconies out, we sort of pushed them in. In the UK, planning laws mean that you need a, an outdoor, private outdoor space for every dwelling. So in this particular project, there are four flats on the ground floor, two beds, and then four one-bed flats on the first floor. This is the facade. So we again looked at breaking down the mass of the building with this sort of playful brick checkerboards using two different colours. And also there's a sort of play on the dot, the light with these sort of recessed pushback spaces in between. And the plan is there are two different repeated plan over the overall plan is split into two, and each plan has each built or block has a communal courtyard, which is a sort of access space for four of the flats. So two of them are accessed from ground floor, and then a central staircase, which is lit from above, leading to above. And then on the first floor, you can see how the same concept of the facade with the sort of plan being pushed backwards and forwards and then creating these courtyards. And then this allows sort of dual aspects for the flats, which sort of open up onto these courtyards. And then this is showing this landscaping area, and we try and create this sort of intimate area at the entrance with the sort of recessed entrance areas. So there's a sort of gradient of the most communal street, and then it's sort of more private as it's recessed here, and then the private terraces above that sort of connect down to the public space below. And then we looked at creating this diamond-shaped pathway to break down the sort of length of the access. The next site, Thornlow Gardens, is a very similar site. Again, garage site surrounded by buildings. Again, we looked at the block offset from the boundaries. And then in this case, they were particularly difficult angles. There's a 25 degree rule in terms of light from the ground floor window of the surrounding building. So that meant that we had to cut back the building from the boundaries. And then again, we inserted pockets for terraces and entrance areas. And in this case, the stair is outside here because of viability, we can lose additional internal space to staircases, so these are on the outside. And then this is six flats on ground floor and then four flats on first floor. And then similar idea of the weave and a play with the brick. In this case, it looks like the same brick, but it's a glazed brick and a matte brick, so you sort of get these alternating reflections in the building. And then we have this sort of blue metalwork that sort of weaves behind the brick and connects the external spaces and the public spaces downstairs. This is the section just showing how it steps back from the adjacent buildings. And there are terraces stepping down, cascading down, and these are... These are sort of outdoor rooms. We had to create the boundary of the balustrade at eye level in order to stop overlooking into the neighbours' buildings. The plan shows, again, the sort of fragmentation of the building, how on ground floor there's this larger plan, and as the building steps up, sort of it gets smaller and smaller with sort of more and more terraces being inserted into the house. And then this, again, we use a similar play with breaking up the external communal area.
And it's directly trying to address the question of keeping artists in the city. And this is quite a key precedent called Black Horse Workshop, which is in Walthamstow. And it provides a workshop for the local community or for anyone, where you can either have training in joinery, glaze slot all the way up. Then the plan itself is very simple in a sense. It's got this, so you've got the central street, this is the ground floor plan. In the middle of it is this vertical circulation core, and all these partitions on either side are sort of flexible, but they're potentially art studios or workshops, and you can, if you want to, you can open it all up and turn the ground floor into a giant gallery. But there's also a cafe point here and auditorium space at the back. On the upper floors, this is where there are 12 artist houses or flats. And the key thing about them is that they are mezzanettes. So there's actually another two floors on top of these ones that are identical. And the key is, so on the lower floor of each unit is the living spaces. And these can open up onto this communal living area. So if you want to, you can double or triple the size of your living room. And on the upper floors, you have the private areas. So there's an internal stair inside each mezzanette. You have the bedrooms and bathroom and a little balcony. And these look out over this double height space. So it really feels like a sort of internal street. And you can see, you can talk to someone on the balcony opposite if you want to. So this section through that shows the kind of real transformation. Pink indicates public area, and you can see how, well, if you keep your doors and walls all shut, it would read like that. You see these double height dramatic communal spaces, but if you choose to open up your private living space into the communal space on the right, you can transform entire floors into communal living spaces. And this is all done through this double stable door, which every unit has, and it's a way of controlling how public or private you want to be. So you can change it from completely closed to completely open. And these are some images of what it might look like. This is the view from the public street inside this new street with the slot visible. And this, there's a, an indication of what zones are public and private. So the public ground floor has this kind of smooth scalloped concrete panels, whereas the upper more private floors have these finely ribbed smaller panels, which are half the width of the larger ones. This is a view inside that double height communal space with the mezzanettes on either side. And the idea is, by creating these like really fantastic communal spaces, you can encourage a strong sense of community and have people who really want to live there and engage with local residents. So this is the view looking the other way, where you get this quite interesting layered views from the one person's private space through the communal living room into a private living room back outside onto a balcony. And this is another kind of series of views, but from the new public space, looking through an artist studio into the public space, etc. So these two projects are trying to show ways of densification, creating densification by sharing space, and therefore kind of allow sort of increasing density without kicking people out of the city. There are just a couple more projects to show different locations, because we're aware this problem is not limited to London. So this is one project in Cardiff that we won the feasibility study for with Loin & Co Architects. It was a collaboration, and it's for 5 new dance studios and education facilities and cafe and gallery, so sort of a big community hub essentially in a sort of area of Cardiff. And we did lots of community stakeholder work. This shows some feet painting consultations that we did with the young classes. The whole of the ground floor in this project is also basically a public space. We're working again with a historic building and sort of recycling and bringing back to life this old, well, actually it's from the 80s, this kind of interesting building that used to be a cinema and a bowling alley. And we inserted some new dance boxes, dance studios, which are boxes, and some more sculptural circulation elements to create a sort of new, bring this building back to life and create a new identity. And what some of the key moves were actually opening up the ground floor completely, so it's completely glazed, and opening up that to the street and welcoming everyone in. And then almost the most important move was cutting out this large picture frame window on the front of the building, which happens to be where the main dance stage is. So from the public street, you can see the main performance, dance performance going on, and you're kind of, it's all about bringing that out to the public. And this is the view from inside that main dance space, looking back out at the street beyond. And the last project for this set is called Qingdao Cultural Center, which is actually a sort of quite a large former textile factory complex, really amazing buildings, which is no longer in use. And the client is looking to transform it into a art district, very much modeled on the Beijing 798 art zone. And we won the competition for this, and this is the sort of over concept for the master plan, which is to create a sort of two main streets, one running north-south, one running east-west, and with a big communal public space in the middle. And the public space is framed by the remaining walls of one of the warehouses with its roof removed, because it's falling down. And the first building on the site that is going to be built is this project, this building up here. And it's working with this old brick structure that had fire and the roof burnt out. And so we have, in this case, it's sort of instead of a linear street, it's more about these pockets of courtyards. This is the sort of AXO view of it. And we inserted a series of glass boxes with creating a new datum level. And this really highlights this irregular profile of the old brick building and the old walls. And these are these courtyards in the middle. And this is what it looks like from the outside. And we wanted to reference the textiles that used to be made there. So you can see there's this frit on the glass that recalls those textiles. And again, here, this is a view of the internal courtyard, one of them, where the landscape, both the landscaping and the frit on top and the actual trees, they kind of all have these references to the building's former use. So these projects sort of sum up, and in fact, the sort of all the projects we've shown show how we're kind of really trying to, we could have all our projects about prioritizing the communal space and letting that be a driver to how the organization of the building works. And we're really keen on developing or continuing dialogues with local governments and trying to deliver sort of beautiful new homes and communities for London. And often geometry is a very important aspect of this in all our projects. So we thought we'd end with a completely different project to show we do sort of all sorts of things. And it's about bubbles and suspension and performing architecture. So. Okay, thank you.
Thank you for that. I think it's quite exciting how many of the sort of the themes that you touched upon kind of resonate with what's happening here at Columbia. I think the the idea of sort of preservation or reuse or recycling of kind of existing infrastructure and buildings and fabric, the kind of entrepreneurialism that I think in a way your office started with a kind of arts yard project, which was sort of self-initiated. But I think since there's three of you, I'd like to kind of frame the response in three points. The first point being the kind of question of crisis. You started with a kind of identity crisis upon graduation and reconciling, you know, your sort of own interests versus kind of academic, the things which you studied in school, and ended on a kind of a cultural crisis. And I think Amal also noted your office started on the heels of the kind of financial crisis. And everything then happened within the kind of milieu of the housing crisis in London. And I think it's sort of worth noting right now, I think it's fair to say that we're on the verge of a kind of social or sort of political crisis, both in the case of in the UK with the Brexit, and also the kind of terrifying political reality that we have here. And the whole world is kind of looking inwards. But at the same time, I think you seem to be looking outwards and kind of diversifying and expanding your own practice and pursuing global work like the Qingdao project that you ended upon. And I think that you all exhibit a kind of calm and coolness in the face of many, many crises, and in fact have a lot of fun, I think, with the foam dome. So I guess the first kind of... this first sort of theme or question, in a way, is how does the new kind of crisis, the impending crisis, perhaps precipitate a sort of another change in your office or something new or kind of different? Maybe I'll just go through all three points and then you can answer whichever ones you, you'd like to. The second point, I think, which is quite interesting, which we talked about earlier too, is a sort of interest in housing as a territory for architectural experimentation, I think, in your words, idealism, which was a central concern, I would say, with kind of modernism and through the 70s with the projects, particularly projects like the Alexandra Road Estate that Catherine presented. And I would say, but in actually the 80s, there was kind of a, from within the discipline, a declining interest in housing, and probably coinciding actually with the sort of graph that you showed of the kind of number of council estates, number of housing units built by councils declining actually coincided with, from within architecture, I would say housing became more peripheral. But I would like to claim, sort of for our generation, I think as evidenced by your work, that housing is kind of cool again, and there's a resurgent interest in housing, and I really appreciate that. And I think it's not, of course, not only in the luxurious, in the service of kind of luxury. The third kind of interesting theme, which your work has, I believe, is kind of geometry, as you said, the figuration, I think, from the kind of the wallpaper in the first project that you showed. But I think it's maybe more accurate to call it pattern, because I think it often involves kind of repetition of geometry at different scales. And it operates on both a kind of ornamental level, but also an organizational level. Particularly in the kind of plans of I think many of the projects you showed actually from the plan first, as a way to kind of present the project. In the vaulted house, the vault geometry repeats in the roof, but also the kind of fireplace, floors, walls, and entrance. In Ott's yard, the geometry comes from the kind of city, from the triangle, and then repeats into the kind of perimeter and envelope of the building, and into the division of the two units and into the materials and kind of textures. And then I think there's a sort of interesting shift in the kind of projects for Croydon, the Drover's Yard project with the kind of crosses. In fact, there the geometry or the pattern doesn't come from the site, but comes kind of internally through your own move to sort of rotate the grid by 45 degrees and actually in a way kind of react against the context. And I think similarly in the Mountain House, it's also kind of an internally generated or sort of initiated geometry. And then I'm quite curious because I think in the latter projects, like the art house, for instance, there is a kind of rigor, also sort of a very much a kind of rigor of the plan, but without maybe as much presence of the kind of geometry or pattern or kind of complexity in the project. And so I'm kind of I guess the final theme, figuration, pattern, geometry, I'm kind of curious, like, how do you, in a way, you know, use, in some cases, a kind of floral or sort of figurative pattern versus in other cases, something much more orthogonal and rigorous and kind of rigid geometries, which I think are kind of equally interesting.
Yeah, well, thanks. Those are great questions. I don't know where to start. I mean, I think maybe starting with the first question, the crisis question, which we definitely seem to be in a crisis. I think one thing that is becoming more aware of is really how you fund architecture in a way, these kinds of projects we're showing, like whether it's public housing or cultural buildings, and it's hard to just rely on the government. Like, where's the actual money going to come from? And I think that's why we're quite interested with the art house project, the idea of this kind of, could people give back as well and pay for their living accommodation that way? So the idea that the artists would volunteer essentially and provide social services in return for this housing. It hasn't really been done before, but there are people sort of starting to talk about that. So I think the issue of funding is kind of increasingly important.
Well, I mean, there's really no funding coming from the government for housing anymore, and so in the situation with Croydon, it's not that the council has given money to develop sites. They are cross-subsidising their huge programme of sites by developing some for market sale, which can pay for others, which are socially rented. And there's, I guess, a question as to whether how far can they sort of liberate the land values in order to provide enough housing. And it's certainly very interesting and pioneering that they're trying. I think there's probably a question about whether it would provide what's needed, which is so huge, and that actually there are going to have to be other ways of providing it. But I think there are lots. You're seeing architects being developers and councils being developers and artists being developers, and there's all sorts of different new modes of clients now, I think.
And lots of self-build projects as well, and that's sort of becoming increasingly interesting.
And this sort of leads on to the sort of housing question that I think, as a young practice, it's this, in a way, the crisis has given us an opportunity to sort of develop our own vision as a response to it. And, for example, all these sites we're building on are so constrained that you have to think differently, and how can you build something that's viable within these very restrained conditions. You have to come up with a unique solution. We can't build terraced houses on these plots. So for us, it's been really exciting to come up with new ideas which these sort of restrictions have created.
Which maybe comes back to the sort of pattern question and how we sort of work both from inside out and outside in. So there's all the site constraints and government constraints, and then there's the brief and how the brief can generate relationships.
And I think that the pattern making is, maybe that is the kind of legacy of our American educations. But that somehow that imposing some kind of new parameter that comes from outside the constraints of the site can generate different kinds of relationships between different programs that are sort of more unexpected, more dynamic, not just formally, but also programmatically. And I think we're really interested, as you sort of highlighted, in the relationship, not just of pattern and as a form-making device, but also how it functions in terms of the organization of the building and the relationships between different rooms and views and more kind of programmatic concerns. So it's trying to find a crossover between those two concerns, I think.
So it sounds like, in a way, maybe to kind of paraphrase your reaction to kind of crisis is to sort of actually engage the kind of economic and policy, the economic parameters and the kind of policies that are, you know, leading to kind of architecture. I'm curious though, like in a way, I think given your work, how influenced your work is by the kind of infill and the sort of pressures and constraints, like the Mountain House then seems to have, I assume, is kind of absent of many of those, more absent of many of those constraints, and yet I think you're equally kind of adept at articulating kind of interesting spaces and kind of sequences and
she had very specific constraints. The Swiss laws are not necessarily in some places I think they do care about whether it looks like a chalet or whatever, but here we were dealing just with very specific rules about height, roof pitch, floor area, and then I suppose the site itself, although it's not really a constraint, there was an idea that you really wanted to take advantage of all of the views, so that in a way became a kind of parameter. And so it's sort of, I guess, wherever you build, there are always going to be some kind of legislative constraints. Unless you're really, you know, maybe in certain areas in China where there's much less law, then it might be different. But I think, all of those projects really grow out of the constraints in some ways.
So the later projects, you identify the more sort of rectilinear and sort of regular geometries in a way. Those are all working with existing buildings. So we don't just impose these geometries mindlessly on sites. They sort of, we work with what's there too, and that's why, to a certain extent, that's why they're like they are.
Yeah, and so I guess that kind of also, I'm also wondering a little bit, I was mentioning last week we had Christian Carrez here, who's talked a lot about his kind of process and how he kind of manufactured crises internally to kind of produce, to generate his sort of work, and you didn't talk much about kind of process, and is it? All the projects do seem kind of inevitable as you present them as kind of reactions against certain things. But what maybe you can talk about that actually? How do things come about? Is it in models? Is it the drawings are kind of amazing? Are they part of the process?
I think the plan, the development of the plan is often the starting point, and the introduction of some kind of geometrical parameters onto the site. I mean, some of them look, they look very simple, they look like they were meant to be. Ott's Yard looks like we found a geometry and gave us a plan, but in fact it's highly sort of fudged, really it was incredibly difficult to make those plans work. And you know, the angle of the wall, if it's out by kind of, a fifth of a degree, it will completely mess up the other end of the house. So everything had to be really, really thought through down to kind of very fine detail. So maybe there is a kind of certain obsessiveness in the process, and maybe also an idea of like bringing things in that make our life really harder than it needs to be. But then also this sort of satisfaction of solving that problem that we've created for ourselves. And maybe that's why some of the projects are quite unusual looking, because possibly no one else would try to push something that really didn't feel like it was working.
It's perseverance. I think when people join our office, they're like, no, this is never going to work. It's never going to work. And then you persevere, push, and then it works. And it's patience.
But drawings are really important to us as well, sort of how you can represent the concept in one moment. So we haven't shown all of them, but every project does have a kind of key drawing that captures the ideas.
And you were actually describing that as kind of, in a way, sort of counter to your education here, where it was like a moment when, you know, kind of the 3D model and 3D modeling seemed like it could kind of eliminate sort of plans and sections from architecture. But that's when did you kind of when did you realize that, or how did that come? How did the kind of rigor of sort of plan come back into the work?
I think it probably came all the way back from Cambridge, because that was quite quite a retro education in a way there, and I think it was also just the realization that if you play with the plan enough, then you can create spaces that are incredibly dynamic once you kind of put them into three dimensions, that you don't necessarily know they're going to feel quite like that when you're designing them. The plan feels very controlled, but then once you start to kind of extrude some of those spaces, you do get very unexpected results. In terms of, I mean, there was something in Art's Yard that I realized after we'd built it, that actually the angles in the house had this kind of effect on the perception of the space of the house, because they kind of exaggerated the feeling of, you expect the room to be a cube or a square, and the splaying of the walls makes it in fact feel much bigger than it is. It kind of exaggerates the perspective. And so you get these kind of funny things coming out of it, actually just working in plan. I think that's not apparent necessarily.
Yeah, and I think a lot of the kind of sophisticated aspects of the art house, for instance, are kind of dictated by the structure. You know, the relationships between kind of individual and collective are really dictated by the kind of the repetition or the modulation of sort of structure and services and elements within the kind of plan. Should we take questions, actually?
It seems that you often have these really high-end clients, coalitions of philanthropy, council, and developers, and vendors have that effects on the client bodies.
Again?
But we can hear you though. Catherine, what do you?
You start.
I mean, I think sort of, for example, every client is different. So, in a way, it's just like working with another person or another body or another organization, and their kind of priorities are slightly different, so, and their kind of structures of working are different, and the way they make decisions is slightly different. It's kind of might take longer to make decisions because there's more people involved.
I think we do a lot of often, even when the client is a single client, there are still a huge number of stakeholders, and something which I think is probably maybe a little different in London than it is here is that almost any building, even if it's not in a conservation area, there's an enormous amount of local democracy that goes into whether a building gets planning. And so if you don't have the support of neighbours, you won't get planning, even if it conforms to all of the regulations and it's well within these kind of degree envelopes.
And it looks good.
Yeah. It doesn't necessarily get planning if you don't bring those people on board. So a lot of what we end up doing is actually just that kind of engagement process, and I think that works also with clients where there are kind of multiple kind of bodies that you have to kind of address them all in such different ways and come up with creative ways of engaging different
And definitely as the projects get bigger, there's so many more layers of that. Like with Rubicon Dance, we did so much consultation because it has dance classes with every kind of age group, from like babies to elderly people, and then sort of different like staff members and the Arts Wales organisation. So we've done a huge amount of that, and I think often it's a positive thing for us too. We kind of really get to know the brief well and understand what they want.
Hello.
It's a very quick question. I'm wondering if, just like thinking about the practice you guys run, I wonder if you do competitions, because it's the projects all seem to be refreshingly direct in terms of who you communicate with, even though it's like a larger constituency. And in the same line, I would like to know what kind of keeps you up at night or what gets you out of bed in the morning. In other words, is there a project that you would like love to do, right? Like with all the crisis and like constant problem solving and, you know, excitement over housing. But is there something that like, you know, that you're like, man, I want to do? Like sometimes, you know, competitions kind of provide, which then links back into like, yeah, you know, the kind of global aspect of it. In other words, like one question we often ask is like, you know, like how would your project change if it would be in X?
We do competitions, but we are trying to limit ourselves because they're so resource heavy. And so a lot of the work that we look for, we try to look for it in more direct ways, but we would love to do some non-housing projects. I think it's fair to say we all would love to do some cultural projects. I would really love to do some more projects that had larger areas of landscape. And I think we really enjoy we're beginning to enjoy these smaller mixed-use projects, and to work on something with much more complexity would be really exciting. And I think we sort of feel ready for that next step of up of complexity at the moment.
I think the competitions we do, although we haven't won any yet. They really allow young practice to sort of bring together their ideas and create a sort of common theme of ideas. So the ones we have done have really sort of pushed us forward as a practice, and so it's worth, we could keep on doing them and regularly, but also looking for other ways of getting work too.
Hello, I just want to say congratulations on your projects. I love everything that your ladies are doing, and I wanted to know what inspired you.
I think probably we're inspired by constraints and difficulties and problems, and trying to make still good architecture out of that, I guess. Yeah.
Hi, I was just curious if there was anything specific that your time in the U.S. as students and practicing brought to your practice in London culturally?
I think there's an amazing energy in particularly in New York and in the East Coast, and in America in general. There's a feeling that you can do things. People are incredibly supportive of entrepreneurial decisions, and that was incredibly refreshing. And I think also a certain feeling that you can just be free with form. You don't need to necessarily pay too much. I mean, obviously our projects are very contextual, but you know, believe me, there are much more contextual architecture going on in Britain that almost you couldn't tell if it was a new project. And I think we felt a bit, when we were there, we felt a bit kind of stultified by that, and we wanted to bring a kind of freshness and really try to explore new types and new forms, which is not actually that common to do there.
In Britain, we're definitely considered the sort of bold architects, and that's definitely coming from here.
Yeah, I mean, I think we could say that our education in England somehow managed to erase the history of formalism. So I think we discovered it to coming here, which is really important.
Hi, how has Brexit changed
Okay, I mean, I guess the house prices have taken a kind of a hit since the the referendum. But is there a silver lining in terms of it's easy to get work overseas, or will there be?
It's hard to know right now. I think that we hope that any deal that gets made allows us still to have our staff, most half European. We do have a Chinese member of staff who has a visa, so I guess suppose the worst case scenario is that all our staff have to get visas, which is a bit expensive, but we would do it for them. I think in terms of house prices, it really remains to be seen. At the moment, people are very cautious in London, and I think until a decision is made, we won't really know. I slightly think that London is still such an amazing city that it will always be a desirable place to live, and within Britain, it will always be the biggest city. So there will always still be a demand for housing, and there's so little of it right now that that there'll still be a lot of people to house, a lot of work for us in that regard. But it's uncertain times.
I think the real risks are that the existing communities are all going to have to leave, and actually house prices are going to keep rising over the long run anyway. There might be a dip, who knows, but we're waiting to see. But it has made everyone more political, I think. Everyone has an opinion on it. And
I was wondering about the representations, that how you represent your drawings and your plans and everything. Although you were talking about most of your projects are housing, is there a way that you came up with a specific sort of mentality of how you're going to present your project? Because there's like a continuity and a flow between one project to the other. So I was wondering if you can just share with us if there's something that, like a platform that you are specific into how you represent your projects.
Yeah, I mean, in terms of the design process, the sort of that kind of works with the representation, we're very collaborative in the way that we design. So we kind of, it comes out of conversations between all of us and sort of crits between all of us. So it's a kind of conversation in the office. And the representational techniques,
I think they look more recently homogenous than they used to. Because we prepared material for the lecture and also for our website recently. I think that the process has always been quite consistent in terms of the pattern making and the kinds of sites that we talked about earlier. And I think that the renderings are taking on their own language gradually. And I think that the line drawings, we kind of made a decision to really see if it was possible to draw everything in line work.
Yeah, but we were doing that from the beginning.
That's true.
it does kind of mirror your work in a way too. I think you use the word crisp to just kind of describe the vaulted house or Arts Yard, and in a way the kind of drawings also mirror that, sort of the kind of sharpness and precision, I think.
Think maybe it's fair to say we're quite interested in being able to communicate quite clearly and directly, and so the kind of distillation of those drawings into this just very clean black and white drawings, we sort of want to be able to convey the idea just using that technique in a really direct way.
But sometimes combining different standard drawing techniques to sort of highlight certain aspects. So I don't know if you remember, but a drawing we did for Red Church Street, it has a sort of section plus two perspectives taken from different kind of vanishing points. So it's not a real representation, but it sort of really conveys the concept. So we do that quite a lot of kind of impossible unfolded drawings.
We have time for one last question.
This one's for Tanya as alumni. What would you say, what would your advice for the students here be? And what was your favorite studio you took here?
Oh.
housing studio where we were partners. My advice would be to, which I said in the podcast too, but to kind of hang on to the idealism that you have as a student. And, you know, architectural office life can be kind of jading, and not to let that kind of get to you. You need to kind of hang on to the fresh thinking that you develop here. I mean, it's an incredible school. There's an amazing faculty at the moment, and you know, you are getting the best education you could want. So really hang on to it and try to continue it into the real world. Yeah, that's what I would say, if you can.
Nice ending point. Thank you.